onward. Surely be me all that I could be when I wanted to be all that I could be. Life seems sad, now I can't even walk without you holding my hand. All that I could do, light on my own. All that I could make it all day long. Thought of myself as a mighty big man. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high, the valleys too wide. His name I'll call, for I didn't trust him. I'll be less of a man, 'cause I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding.
Good morning, half of Church 247. How are we this morning?
Good morning, Tyler.
Your elder of the week is Jim Lamb. If you have any questions or concerns, you can contact him. Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, kids 247 will meet, and the heads will meet in their respective classrooms. Men and ladies will be in here for the continuation of I've Been Wondering. Saturday, September 11th at 11:30, we will feed the people in need. The bowl for donations is right here beside Teresa Jean. The blue bowl is for feeding the homeless donations. Sunday, September 12th at 12:30 at the camp, the youth will have a cookout. Sunday, September 12th at 6 p.m. is the day we've all been waiting for. You're just going to have to come and see, because I don't know either. I'll be here to find out. Saturday, September 18th at 6 p.m. at the camp is bring your own meal, amen to the food, and join us in a prayer walk. Sunday, September 19th, our 247 a.m. small groups will start back up. Saturday, September 25th at 4 o'clock is the singles and salt luau at the camp. Please RSVP to Lori Brock if you plan to attend. Sunday, October 3rd at 10 a.m. is Friend Day. This year it will be Bring Your Own Dish. Bring your own dish to Friend Day. Invite an unchurched friend and join us at the camp on October 3rd. October 9th at 6 p.m. will will be a ladies' craft night. If you are interested, please see Crystal Blakely. And Sunday, October 31st at 4 o'clock at the camp is Trunk or Treat. I really hope that's all of them because that's a bunch. Let's stand and worship with praise 247.
Stand against the power of our God.
such an easy thing for you to do. Your hand is moving right now. You're still showing up at the tomb of every Lazarus. And your voice is calling me out. Right now, I know you're able. And my God will come through again. And you can do all.
Extensive prayer list. These are a few new prayer requests that we've received this morning. Friends of Eunice Morris, Belinda Wade, and Richard Chance, they've been hospitalized with COVID. And Ada's mom still has an infection, and when she quits taking the antibiotic, the infection returns. If you'd like to call out some names this morning, people.
My husband, Dwayne.
Jason Osborne.
Joe.
Diane.
Amen.
Children and grandchildren.
Amen. Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we just raise these requests up to you this morning, Lord. We just thank you for who you are in our lives. We love you, and we thank you for each and every day that you give us, Lord. Help us to continue to make a difference in other people's lives. We lift these special people up to you once again, Lord. Lord, just thank you for your love, your grace, and your mercy bestowed on us, Lord. We thank you for each thing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
somebody, I believe it, hold on to me. When I miss the light, the night is stolen. When I'm slamming all the doors you've opened, hold on to me. Hold on.
He's an attorney here in town, and he has a wonderful story. So let's give Matt a warm welcome as he comes in. Thank you, Matt.
Good. Okay, I can tell that I am turned on here. And it's, for the record, Matt Henderson, not Matt Thompson. I know Matt Thompson, and he's a good guy. But he's not the good guy up here today. It is an honor to be here, so thank you very much. I know you had nothing to do with my being here, but I appreciate the fact that you've taken the time to show up. I realize it's Labor Day weekend, and probably all of you knew your pastor wouldn't be here today, and so it was a great opportunity to sleep in or do some of those things around the house that you've been putting off, and yet here you are. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. I've had the good fortune of speaking at dozens of churches over the years. As a matter of fact, right here in your neighborhood, I've spoken at Northbrook probably a half dozen times or more, and preached a couple of sermons perhaps, and have spoken at Bone Springs First Baptist for Hank Williams one Sunday. He allowed me to preach both services, so I'm familiar with this side of town. But I really enjoy doing this. I mean, it really is kind of neat to have a chance to voice my trust in the Lord and to have a chance to share a little bit of my testimony and how I look at things with folks that, you know, some folks here I know, and some folks here I'm just now meeting, and I'm glad to meet you, so thank you. Well, I stand up here before you very, very humbly, you know, a sinner saved only by grace and blood. You know, as I look at it 2,000 years ago, Jesus died for my sins and rose for my salvation. And I sure am glad that he did. Today I'd like to talk with you a little bit about what the scripture says about God's plan of salvation. By way of background, my wife and I have been married for 54 years. We have been parents to 12 kids, the first two the old-fashioned way, and the next 10 adopted. We became born-again Christians in our late 40s, and we said, God, what you want us to do with our lives? And we felt like he said, I want you to adopt some special kids that maybe other white couples wouldn't adopt. And we adopted a biracial infant girl. And then God kept sending along blessings, and we kept adopting them. So here I am at age 78 with two kids still at home, a 22-year-old Down syndrome little girl, a full-blooded Lumbee Indian from the Lumberton area of North Carolina, and a 13-year-old son from Guatemala that was going to be abandoned. Nobody adopted him. So, you know, God has just blessed me with a special family. We adopted our first child with no thought in mind that we'd adopt any more. But as I tell people, every time we adopted one, we felt that was another blessing from God, and you just hate to turn down blessings from God. So, you know, when he came along and said, man, do y'all want to adopt another kid? And all the prior ones had been just blessings. You know, it's hard to say, no, we're full up on blessings, God. We don't want any more. So we never did. By way of background, I graduated from Vanderbilt Law School in 1967. And that was when the Vietnam War was really raging. And as I was a senior in law school in 66 and 67, and Tet had just happened, what they call the Tet Offensive, the year before, it just it bothered me a lot that we were losing 500 young American men who didn't ask to be over there. I always thought it was a worthless war, and I still do, who were dying monthly. And, you know, I was apparently going to live a good life. Am I cutting in and out? I mean, does it sound like I am? Are we okay? Okay, good, because it sounds like it to me. And I said, wait a minute, I don't want to irritate you guys. So in any event, so I had met the young woman who became my wife at a fraternity party in 1966, and we talked about getting married after 3 weeks. We set the date after 6 weeks, and we got married 10 weeks to the day that we met 54 years ago. But 4 days before we got married, you know, what was happening in Vietnam really got to me. So I walked across the street from the law school there in Nashville, Tennessee, and went to the Marine Corps recruiter and enlisted in the Marine Corps. And I told him that I wanted to be in the infantry. I wanted to be a platoon commander, and I wanted to serve in Vietnam. And so he signed me up, and as I was leaving his office, he said, Matt, I want to be honest with you. He said, Mr. Henderson, I guess, I want to be honest with you. When you graduate from law school and take a bar exam, the Marine Corps really needs lawyers, and automatically you're going to be made a lawyer, you'll be promoted to captain, and you'll never see a day of action in Vietnam. And so in that one block from the recruiting station to the law school, I said, well, I'll show them. I'll take a bar exam. And I did. But I tell people, in my first bad firefight in Vietnam, I said, Lord, have I made a fatal mistake? The 71 need men who served with me while I was in Vietnam, 41 were wounded and 15 were killed. The guy who took my place was dead 2 days later, and the guy who took his place was dead 2 weeks later. So, you know, it really was a war of attrition, and it really was worthless. And I really wasn't a Christian back in those days. I was a Laodicean at best, mentioning Revelation a minute ago, chapter 3, the lukewarm church. Or a cardinal Christian perhaps would be a more accurate statement. But in Vietnam, you're drinking water. You got thirsty quickly. It was so hot and so humid that my men would take along 4 or 5 canteens of water, and it would be gone in a couple of hours. And so we had to look for the water. We had to look for the streams, and streams are always located in valleys. And so even though I wasn't much of a Christian, every day I said, yay, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because, you know, I knew that that's where the ambushes would probably going to take place, and it was really an unsafe place to be, but we had to go there to get more. In any event, here I am. Thank you, Lord. Sinner saved only by grace and blood. Today, in thinking about what I wanted to share with you, I thought that I'd like to look at some scripture that deals with God's plan for our salvation. You know, what exactly is, I guess, the scripture that counts for salvation in heaven with God? So, you know, we all know John 3:16, for God so loved the world. Maybe some of you know Matthew 18:3, unless you become like a small child. My Down's daughter, 22 years old, is like a small child. She kind of reminds me of what I think God was describing when he talked about us becoming like a small child, Ephesians 2:8. You're saved by grace through faith and not of yourself. It's a gift of God. But you know, that's kind of a statement of fact. We're saved by grace through faith. John 3:16, for God so loved the world. That's kind of a statement as well. So, I mean, what's really required according to God for us to be saved? Now, I like Romans. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. You know, that's a really neat scripture for me to be able to use in my office, because often I'll be talking to people there at a conference table, and I'll say, you know, may I ask you a personal question? Are you a Christian? Have you accepted only Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And now I'll share with them Romans 10:9, if you confess with your mouth, and I'll say, you know, do you believe that? And they say, yes. And I said, well, let's take time out here. Let's confess with our mouths that Jesus is our Lord, and we'll just sit there. Perhaps it's a man or a woman. I'll hold their hands and I'll say, Lord, you know, we believe that you are Lord. And then I said, hey, do you believe that? And he said, yes. And I said, well, I got good news, because you've confessed that with your mouth, you're going to be saved. So it's really a neat little non-offensive, I think, witnessing tool. But today I want to look at the role of the Holy Spirit. I mean, what is the Holy Spirit? Who is the Holy Spirit? God's plan of salvation. Okay. I want to start with Matthew chapter 12. So I'm going to look at that. You don't need to. Matthew is the first of the synoptic gospels. You know, Matthew, Mark, and Luke are three books from God that are remarkably similar, but definitely not identical. And the way I look at it is here's the way I see God's plan for us to read the Bible. If we start with Matthew, and something's important, God's going to mention it. If it's really important, God's going to say it again in Mark. And if it's really, really, really important, we'll see that again in the book of Luke. So let's look and see what God has to say about his plan of salvation. He said, Jesus, this is Jesus speaking. This is in Matthew 12:31. Therefore, I say to you, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven them. But the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven them. Now listen to this. I can't believe that Jesus said this, and I don't advocate anyone ever doing it. Anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man. Now Jesus described to himself as the Son of Man 81 separate times in the New Testament. Only once did he allude to himself as being a son of God. So the description Jesus used of himself was the Son of Man. Anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him. But whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven him either in this age or the age to come. So, I mean, that pretty well covers it. Won't be forgiven this age or the age to come. Now who is the Holy Spirit? Well, let's go back to the beginning. In the beginning, there was either one of two things. There was either that speck floating around that, according to astronomers and physicists, blew up and became the Big Bang Theory, or there was a creator. You and I both know that we didn't all come from a speck out there just floating around that was not there one day and popped up the next day. We came because God created us. Now the God that we know and love has seen fit to show himself to us in three different ways. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I mean, here I'm with you today, I'm dressed casually. If I were going to try a lawsuit tomorrow in federal court, you would see the same me, but I'd be wearing a three-piece suit, and I would look like a lawyer getting ready to go to court. And if you had seen me yesterday with my kids taking trash to the landfill and going out to breakfast, I'd have been wearing shorts and a t-shirt and sandals. So same me, but I would have looked. I'd look different. Three different ways that I looked. And God has seen fit to show himself to us in three different fashions. You know, the Father, you can make out a good argument, created the universe, created the earth, you know, created your mom and dad. Let you be the person that you are today because of the work of the Father. The Son, you know, he came to earth for 33 years old. He put in a cameo appearance of no more than 3.5 years. You know, he came to earth for a lot of reasons, primarily to die for our sins and to rise for our salvation. So in a sense, the work of both the Father and the Son is complete. You remember Jesus' dying words on the cross? It is finished. So Jesus had done what he was sent here to do, and that is pay the price for our sins and eventually rise for our salvation, something that we couldn't do on our own. But you see, the work of the Holy Spirit's ongoing. The work of the Holy Spirit is still on. The Holy Spirit's with us today. You know, when I walked in any church, I tell people, regardless of the denomination, there are only two requirements. Number one, only Jesus Christ is Lord. Number two, God's Holy Spirit's always present. You know, I could tell that when I walked in here. I could tell this young lady and this young lady, these two ladies were singing. You know, I don't know if you've ever gotten to church early. I got here about 10 o'clock this morning. It was awesome because I got to hear all the singing two or three times. And I, you know, even though I don't sing, I kind of felt like I could probably be up here singing. No, I didn't go that far. But it was a blessing to be here. So in any event, so that's what Matthew has to say. Now, I told you that if God thinks it's important, we'll see it again. Let's look over at Mark 3:29 and see what it has to say about the Holy Spirit. It says this. It says, 3:28. This is Jesus talking. Assuredly I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the sons of men, and whatever blasphemies they may utter, that he who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is subject to eternal condemnation. Now, blaspheme in this context probably means rejects. So I think we could probably safely say that whoever rejects the Holy Spirit is subject to eternal condemnation. Now, once again, I told you that as I read the New Testament, if God thought it was important, he'd mention it in Matthew, he'd reaffirm it in Mark. If we look over at Luke 12:10, we will see that he said, now let me just find on to chapter 11, it helps to be in chapter 12, and he said, this is Jesus, and anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him. But to him who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit, he will not be forgiven. Okay, let's look at briefly John, and this is some famous scripture that we all know. John 3:3 and John 3:5. So let's look over here and see what Jesus had to say. And this is the very famous dialogue between Jesus and Nicodemus. And we all remember that. Now, this is a kind of a how to do it scripture. This is how to get saved. This is how to get right with God. This is really important. This isn't a statement of fact. This is a statement of how to do it. Let's look and see what happened. In John 3:1, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night. Obviously, he didn't want to be seen, and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher come from God. Now, he didn't acknowledge that Jesus was God in human form. He said that you're a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Now, that was a statement of fact by Nicodemus. So he wasn't asking a question. He was just making a statement. We know you've come from God because you can do things that other folks can't do. And Jesus said, as Jesus often did, he often took the opportunity of responding to something with a profound statement, even though he wasn't being asked a question. And Jesus said, assuredly, and answered and said to him, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Okay, so you've got to be born again, according to Jesus, to see the kingdom of God. And the question is, what does it mean to be born again? What does born again mean? Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of the water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. So Jesus' answer is, you have to be born again. You have to be born of the water. Now, what does born of the water mean? Well, if your Bible's like mine, it gives five different explanations how Bible scholars over the years have thought, well, maybe it means this, maybe it means this, and maybe it means that. I don't agree with any of them personally, and if we have time, I'll tell you what, whatever it's worth, I think. But there's no question that being born of the Spirit means allowing God's Holy Spirit to come into your life. No longer conformed, but transformed by the presence of God's Holy Spirit in your life. Look over at John chapters 14, 15, and 16 if you're following along in your Bible. Here's what Jesus had to say about the Holy Spirit. So remember now, it's an unpardonable sin to blaspheme or reject the Holy Spirit. Remember that, at least from Matt Henderson's point of view, of the three faces of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one that's most important today on earth is the Holy Spirit. That's why I think you can't reject the Holy Spirit, because it's alive and well. If you're a Christian today, it's because God's Holy Spirit has grabbed hold of and convinced you. Let's see what Jesus said about the Holy Spirit. If you love me and keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper. So another helper. So right now we don't know who that other helper is, because Jesus described him as another helper. That he may abide with you forever. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, and that's true of the Holy Spirit. The world doesn't know about the Holy Spirit, because he neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. So that's kind of a little preview of who the Holy Spirit is. Let's look down at 14 a little bit further. But the helper, you know, that's the way Jesus described him, another helper. But the helper, then Jesus says, the Holy Spirit. So we know the helper that Jesus was referring to was the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. So, hey, wait a minute, what's the role of the Holy Spirit? Start reminding us about Jesus. You know, that's why people didn't forget about Jesus 10 years after he died, or 50 years after he died, or 100 years after he died, or during the Dark Ages, because the Holy Spirit was alive and well, and it was out there grabbing hold of those of us who God foresaw would accept Jesus as Lord and Savior to convince us and remind us. Let me look over in chapter 15. This is what Jesus said. When the Helper comes, whom I shall send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, he will testify of me. So if you're a born-again Christian today, if you're someone who knows that Jesus Christ only is Lord, if you're someone who doesn't have a plan B, because there is no plan B, plan A is the only plan, and that's the Jesus plan. Purpose for the Holy Spirit is to tell us, to testify about me. And then a little further on in chapter 16, Jesus said, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, because they do not believe in me. So sin means separation from God, disobedience to God, not believing in Jesus. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. So what Jesus was saying, apparently this was God's plan. God didn't plan on both Jesus and the Holy Spirit being here at the same time. You see, that's why Jesus said it's imperative, it's important that I go. And in effect, Jesus was going to tag the hand of the Holy Spirit. And when he did, he was going to send the Holy Spirit to earth to convince us, to tell us all, to remind us of what Jesus said, and more importantly, who he was, so that we could be saved. When I first got saved, and I'm not really sure when it was, but when I at least first came forward, thought of myself as a John 3:3 and John 3:5 Christian, it was probably in the mid-80s. But what worried me was the fact that when I thought about it, I really was concerned that I hadn't been born again. That even though I'd accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that I hadn't been born again. And so I wondered, I asked myself, I asked God, you know, God, is it possible for me to accept only your Son as Lord and Savior and yet not be born again? Could it be possible that there is, for some of us, a lag period, some period of time where we've accepted Jesus, we believe on Him only. There's no other game plan other than Jesus Christ, but we really haven't been born again. And so I found Acts. Let me read to you Acts, a little bit from Acts chapter 8. Now, when it's the first third of Acts, as those of you who read Acts often know, the first third of Acts is always John, and almost always John and Peter. The second two-thirds of Acts is always Paul. So this is chapter 8, so we know it's going to be John and Peter. And here's what we're told in chapter 8, verse 14. Now when the apostles who were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. Now Samaria is kind of a neat place. You know, the Jews hated the Samaritans because the Samaritans were kind of like most of the kids that I've adopted, my wife and I've adopted. They were mixed. You know, they weren't pure Jews. They were mixed. They were a combination of Jews and Gentiles. But I find it interesting that in the New Testament, God mentions the Samaritans three times. You know, one is the story of the Good Samaritan. We all know that story. One is the story of the woman at the well. And if I remember to, I'm going to mention that with you before I wrap up today. And the other one was where there were 10 lepers who were healed. And Jesus said, go and show yourself to the priest. And 9 of them left and didn't come back. But one of them came back to thank Jesus. And the Bible says, and he was a Samaritan. So the point is that even though the Jews thought down bad of the Samaritans on three different occasions where they're mentioned by name and who they are and where they're from are mentioned in a favorable light. But in any event, so here we got Samaria received the word of God. They sent Peter and John. So like I said, when it's the first third of Acts, it's always going to be Peter and John, who when they had come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For as of yet, he had fallen upon none of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Now, of course, the laying on of hands, at least as I read the Bible, was ended when the apostles left. So no longer is it need. Now, you may feel differently, but as I see it, no longer is it necessary for someone to lay hands on you. You just simply have to ask Jesus to come into your life, and you have to be convinced and convicted that only Jesus is Lord. But look at Acts chapter 19. Now, the second half, remember, second two-thirds of Acts is always going to be Paul. 19, verse 1. So let's see what we've got so far. We know that God consists of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We know that in Matthew, Jesus said, it's okay to blaspheme or reject me, although I would never advocate that. We know that all three Gospels said there's only one sin for which there is never, never, never a pardon, and that is to blaspheme or reject the Holy Spirit. We know that in Jesus' dialogue with Nicodemus, Jesus talked about the need to be born again, whatever that first birth was, and then receive the Holy Spirit. And we now know from looking at Acts chapter 8 that there were people, including Matt Henderson, who saw the truth, made the right choice, but still, at least from my point of view, had not become born again, had not been convinced or convicted by God's Holy Spirit. Let's see what it says in chapter 19 of Acts. And it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus. And finding some disciples, he said to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? And so they said to him, we have not so much as heard whether there is a Holy Spirit. I mean, how could they receive the Holy Spirit? They didn't know the Holy Spirit existed. I remember one of my pastor friends in the past said it's the forgotten third of the Trinity, perhaps the most important, but the forgotten third of the Trinity. And Paul said to them, into what then were you baptized? So they said, into John's baptism. Then Paul said to them, John indeed baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is, on Jesus Christ. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them. So you see, there can be, if you're like me, maybe right now you're in a position where you've accepted only Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, but you don't know whether or not you've really been born again. And is it really important that you be born again? I mean, you know, maybe me and others are making a big deal of that. Let's look at Luke chapter 10, verses 25 to 29. This is kind of incredible, I think. And I've always liked this because it's the only time in the Bible that God puts the lawyers in kind of a good light, okay? And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested Jesus, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Now, I mean, that's the question for everyone, everyone who's ever lived. You know, at my age, 78, I'm going to be here next week or next month or in 5 years or in 10 years. I mean, and you're not going to be here 100 years from now, even the youngest who are in here today. So every one of us should ask ourselves, what, according to God, is necessary to receive eternal life in heaven? Now, we're all going to get eternal life. I mean, hey, I've got some good news. You're going to get heaven. You're going to get heaven. You're going to be live forever eternal life one of two places. Initially, it's going to be hell or heaven, and ultimately, it's going to be the lake of fire or the New Jerusalem. So, I mean, you know, the good news is everybody's going to get eternal life. The bad news is if you don't make the right choice, you're going to spend it in the very undesirable place. Okay, so, teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? So this is this lawyer asking the question. Now, Jesus, as he so often did, answers a question with a question. He doesn't give us a bold answer. For years and years, I missed this because when I became a Christian in the mid-80s, I had a red letter Bible. And see, so I missed this because the answer was given by the lawyer, not by Jesus. And I highlighted the red letter stuff, and then I'd come back and read the red letter stuff, and then I'd come back and read it, and I kept missing this really, really, really important scripture. He said to him, what is written in the law? What is your reading in this? So this is Jesus asking the lawyer, what's your take on it? You know, how do you look at it? How do you feel about it? How do you analyze it? And so the lawyer answered and said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all of your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said to him, you have answered rightly. Do this and live. So salvation is a twofold requirement. Number one, God stands out in front of everything else in this world and everyone else in this world that we love. And number two, with regard to our neighbors, and we go on to read the story of the Good Samaritan, with regard to our neighbors, we think of them just as highly as we think of ourselves. But now, let's look at that first part. When I became what I want to say was a born-again Christian in the 80s, I tried to be really honest with God. You know, I always tell people two places to be honest are in your conversations with God or in being in church and in court. I mean, those are two places where you really ought to be honest. And so, you know, I say, God, you know, I know what Luke 10, 25 to 29 says. I know you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. You know, I know, God, that you are entitled. You demand and are entitled to be in the first place. But I used to say, God, you know, I got to be honest with you. I mean, my wife stayed with me when most women wouldn't because of being an unfaithful husband. My wife stayed with me when most women wouldn't because of the fact that I was so close to being an alcoholic. And so I said, God, I got to be honest with you. My wife's number one. And my kids, they're number one. I mean, you're a close second. You're important to me. You know, and I set that off. Someplace over the last 10 or 15 or 20 years, God has come into my life, and He has broken into the front of the line. And now I can confess to you that God is number one. And my wife and my kids are a very distant second. And I think when that happened, whenever it was, I don't know the year, I don't know the decade, but whenever that happened to me, I feel like that made it such that I could say, I have indeed been born again, because I have indeed put God first in my life. And I ask you, can you say the same thing when you drive home today or when you go to sleep at night? Are you going to say, Lord, thank you so much for saving my wretched soul from the pits of hell? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I love you, Lord. I love you. I mean, you came to earth and died a painful, humiliating death on the cross. I mean, why did He do that? Why did He just zap people? Why did He just come to earth and say, zap, 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 do you believe me? Nope, zap, zap, zap. Do you believe me? Hesitation, zap, zap, zap. I mean, everybody would come around to believing in Him pretty quickly. But that was not God's plan. He was willing to die a painful, humiliating, being spit on death on the cross, because He wanted us in this room today to spend eternity in heaven. I mean, hey, praise the Lord. Aren't we glad that He did that? Aren't we glad that He loved us that much to do that? So the question for you is, the thought I want to leave you with is, can you honestly, speaking to yourself and to God, can you honestly say, when you go to sleep at night, to when you go to sleep tonight, can you honestly say that you've been born again? Can you honestly say that God only is in first place? I feel like, at least for me, when I got to a point where I could say that and believe that and mean that, that I had truly been born again. Let's go back real quick. Remember John 3:3 and John 3:5? Remember I said that with regard to being born of the water, the Bible scholars had picked five possibilities. You know, does it mean being born? Does it mean being baptized? What exactly does it mean? Well, I tell you what I think, and this will be number six on the list, or at least not in the top five. When Jesus had His conversation with the woman at the well, do you remember the Samaritan woman? That's John chapter 4. Remember, she was the woman who had been married five times previously, was living with a man who wasn't her husband. You remember how Jesus described Himself? He said, I am the living woman. So it seems to me that if you must be born of the water and born of the Spirit, and we all agree the only way to be saved is to accept only Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, why wouldn't the water part of that equation be the living water, and that is Jesus Christ? Am I right? Apparently, the Bible scholars think I'm not. And I'm not asking to be right, and I'm not asking that you agree with me. I'm just saying that that seems to me to be a possibility. So once again, the bottom line is, can you today, tomorrow, next week, next month, next year, before you draw your final breath, can you honestly say that Jesus Christ and only Jesus Christ is first in your life? First ahead of spouse, first ahead of kids, first ahead of everything else, but number one in your life. And if you can say that, at least Matt Henderson on theology, it seems to me that you can say, thank you, Lord, I've been born. Okay, let's close with the prayer. I don't even know what time we're supposed to get out, but thank you, Lord. I see it's almost 11 o'clock, so at least I haven't run over. You know, when you're up here speaking and you don't use notes, you always worry that one or two things will happen. One is you're going to get up here and in about 5 minutes be through. And you all feel like you didn't get your money's worth. Or number two, I look up there and it's 11:45, and I know your stomachs are growling and you've been thinking for a long time, where are we going to have lunch today? I mean, you know, I'm a Southern Baptist, so I know what it's like to start thinking about like, amen, brother. So in any event, let me close with a prayer. Let me thank you once again. Thank you for being here today. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you so much. I mean, I really, really, really am honored and appreciate your pastor. You know, now this is what happens to me when pastors invite me to speak. They're almost never here. They just kind of trust that hopefully I won't go too far astray. And you know, it's a privilege to be here. Great to see you today. Let's close with a prayer. Lord, we love you so much, Lord. We thank you for being so awesome, so awesome, so wonderful. We thank you for everything about you, Lord. We thank you for your life and your death and your Holy Spirit that you sent to earth to convict us of the truth that only Jesus Christ is Lord. Guide us, Lord. Direct us, Lord. Be with us from this minute forward for the balance of our lives. And allow us to seek only to serve and honor you in Jesus' precious name. God bless you. God bless America. God bless all of you here. Thank you very much.